Thank you. So first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the invitation. So what I will be talking about is cosmic inflation and quantum mechanics. And what I want to do in this talk is to argue that inflation is not only a very successful model to describe the early universe, but it's also a useful playground to study and discuss fundamental questions of quantum mechanics. So I have organized the talk in three parts. The first one, I will remind you some basic facts about inflation, and I will also say a few words about its observational status. And then in the second part, I will focus on the part of the inflationary scenario that makes use of quantum mechanics. And finally, in the third part, I will try to discuss whether, thanks to inflation, we can see some quantum mechanical effects in the sky. And of course, at the end, I will conclude. So let me start with the first part, a brief description of what inflation is. So by definition, inflation is a phase of accelerated expansion that took place in the early universe. And here, you have a sketchy representation of the timeline of the universe. This is the Big Bang here. We are here, something like 13 or 14 billion years after the Big Bang. And here you have the evolution, the expansion of the universe according to the standard model of cosmology, which is the hot Big Bang model. So this is made of radiation-dominated era, then the matter-dominated era. And nowadays, we have this mysterious dark energy-dominated era. And here, the expansion of the universe is decelerated. And why is it decelerated? Well, it's easy to understand. It's because there is the Big Bang, which gives some initial pinch for the expansion of the universe. But then gravity is an attractive force, so it will have the tendency to slow down the expansion of the universe. And this is the reason why. In the standard evolution case, a double dot, so a dot means derivative with respect to time, the expansion is decelerated. And on this plot, inflation is here. So it's slightly after the Big Bang and before the hot Big Bang phase. Actually, here I have represented the scale factor versus time. So the scale factor is a function which tells you how the universe is expanding with time. So you see that inflation here corresponds to a short burst during which the universe is exponentially growing, and then inflation stops and the standard evolution takes over. So it's interesting to consider this phase of evolution, inflation, because this allows you to solve some problems of the hot Big Bang phase. So the hot Big Bang model is a very successful model. You can explain many, many astrophysical observations with this model, but nevertheless, it has issues. And all these issues can be fixed by postulating that there was a phase of inflation in the early universe. So how can we produce this phase of inflation? Well, it is believed that inflation is actually driven by a scalar field. So why is it so? First of all, we are talking about something which happens in the early universe. So early universe means high energy. And at high energies, the correct framework to describe matter is field theory. So a scalar field seems to be a good candidate. But moreover, the energy density of a scalar field is given by its kinetic energy plus potential energy, but its pressure is given by the difference between those two quantities. So imagine that you have a potential which is almost flat. It means that the field will roll down the potential very slowly. Therefore, the kinetic energy will be small, will be subdominant compared to the potential energy, and therefore this means that the pressure of the system will be negative. And negative pressure in the context of general relativity means accelerated expansion. And so this is called the slow roll phase. And then you have to stop inflation because we don't want to spoil the successes of the standard model of cosmology. And usually this happens in the vicinity of the ground state of the system, which means here the minimum of the potential. So what happens is that at some point, the potential is no longer flat enough to support inflation. The potential close to the minimum becomes steep. If it becomes steep, this means that the field will speed up. This means that the kinetic energy will increase, the pressure will become positive, and inflation will stop. And then the field will oscillate at the bottom of its potential. It will decay, and the decay product will thermalize, and this is how you start the radiation-dominated epoch of the hot Big Bang model. This is how you smoothly connect inflation to the subsequent hot Big Bang phase. So this is the broad picture. Now let's try to put some numbers. And well, there is one important scale in this theory, which is the Hubble parameter. This is A dot over A. This is the expansion rate of the universe. Or equivalently, you can discuss also the problem in terms of the inverse of this expansion rate, which is the Hubble radius. So physically, intuitively, the Hubble radius tells you at which length scale you should take into account the fact that the universe is expanding. If you consider a physical phenomenon, the characteristic scale of which is much smaller than the Hubble radius, then you do not need to take into account the fact that the universe is expanding. If you perform a tabletop experiment in this room, you don't care about the fact that the universe is expanding. Yes. This is because the size of this room is much smaller than the Hubble radius today. On the contrary, of course, if you have a physical phenomenon with a characteristic scale which is of the order or even larger than Hubble radius, then taking into account the fact that the universe is expanding is mandatory. So it's interesting to represent the evolution with time of this Hubble radius. And typically, you will obtain something like that. So this is Hubble radius, the log of the Hubble radius versus time. This is the log of the scale factor, which is also known as the number of e-folds. And you see that during inflation, this scale is almost a constant. And then when inflation stops and you start the hot Big Bang phase, it is growing at different rates depending whether you are in the radiation or matter-dominated epochs. And to put some numbers, we don't know the value of the Hubble radius during inflation, but we know that it has to be larger than 10 to the 5 times the Planck length, or in terms of the expansion rate, we know that the expansion rate has to be smaller than 10 to the 13 GeV. And for many models of inflation, H will be of this order of magnitude. So this means that inflation is really, by particle physics standard, a very high energy phenomenon. You see, 10 to the 13 GeV would be completely hopeless to reach this scale at the LHC in Geneva, for instance. And to give also a comparison, the Hubble the expansion rate today in a particle physics unit is 10 to the minus 42 GeV. So the expansion today by particle physics standard is a low energy phenomenon. And in this universe, if you consider a given wavelength, it has an interesting story that I have tried to represent here. So suppose that you have a wave which is propagating in the expanding universe. Because the universe is expanding, the wavelength of the wave will grow with time, proportional to the scale factor. So this means that in this plot, this will be this straight line. So this means that initially, it starts at the beginning of inflation. You start at the beginning of inflation with a wavelength which is much smaller than the Hubble radius. So this means that initially, your wave does not feel the fact that the universe is expanding. Then it crossed out the Hubble radius during inflation. Then it starts to feel the expansion. And then it re-enters the Hubble radius, either during radiation or matter-dominated era, depending on the wave number of this wave. So what about the observational status of inflation? So I am sorry, this is a busy plot, but I am going to explain it. So this is a plot which represents the current observational status of inflation. So here on the x-axis, I have put a quantity which describes the ability of a given model of inflation to fit the data. So if you are familiar with statistics, here this is the Bayesian evidence of a model. So this means that if I am on the right side of the plot, the model is good. If I am on the left side of the plot, the model is not good. And each circle represents one model of inflation. The size of the circle has no meaning. It should be just large enough to put the, to write the acronym of the model. And you know, or you probably know that one problem of inflation is not to find one good model. The problem of inflation is to, let's say, navigate in a landscape of hundreds of different models that have been proposed in the last 30 years. So here you have the calculation of the model performance for something like 200 models. And well, even if we are not going to use it, I just tell you what the vertical axis is. So this is this, here is plot a quantity which tells you how much this reheating phase where the fields oscillate is constrained by the data. But what we are really interested in is to find the best model of inflation. And therefore, what we have to do on this plot is simply to look at the extreme right in order to find the model that fits the data in the best possible way. And by the data, I mean the measurement of the CMB anisotropies obtained by the Planck satellite last year. And therefore, the winner is this potential, which is the Starobinsky model. So it was it's interesting because this was one of the first models proposed for inflation. It was proposed by Alexei Starobinsky in 79. And it's also, it has also an interesting aspect. This model can be viewed as a model where the field that drives inflation, so the inflaton field, is the Higgs field. So in this framework, in fact, you even do not need to postulate additional physics beyond the standard. And you see, this belongs to a category that we call plateau inflationary models. So the potential is flat at infinity. And very popular models of inflation, such a simple parabola, m square phi square, or lambda phi to the 4, are now ruled out by the data. So if you want to construct a good model of inflation, you should come up with a potential which is doing something like that and not something. Okay, so I think this is it for the first part, and let me now come to the second part. So now I am going to describe the theory of cosmological or inflationary fluctuations of quantum mechanical origin. So it starts from the following fact that the universe, our universe, is not homogeneous and not isotropic. It's obvious when we look at the sky, we see galaxies, clusters of galaxies. When we look at the last scattering surface, the surface at which the CMB was produced, we see temperature anisotropies and so on. So given this observational fact, we can ask two questions. First of all, how do they grow? How those inhomogeneities grow? And also, what is their origin? So how do they grow? We think we know the answer to that question, and we think that they grow by gravitational instability. And this is confirmed by the observations because, I mean, the inhomogeneities are today of order one. We have galaxies, empty space, galaxies. While we know that these inhomogeneities were very small in the early universe because when we look at the CMB, we see temperature anisotropies of the order of 10 to the minus 5. Delta T over T is 10 to the minus 5. So what we think is that in between, from the CMB anisotropies, so in some sense, the CMB anisotropies are the seeds for the structure that we observe today. And we go from 10 to the minus 5 to 1 by gravitational instability. And then comes the question of their origin, because we have a nice amplification mechanism, but if there is nothing to amplify, it's not so useful. So what's the origin of the of those fluctuations? And as you probably know, according to inflation, the source for those fluctuations are the quantum fluctuations of the inflaton field, so the field responsible for inflation, and of the gravitational field, because the two are coupled through the Einstein equations. So since this is important for this conference, I am going to spend a few slides about this question. So how... Not today, not today. Today is of order one. I mean, you have a huge void and you have clusters of matter in the universe. It's really of order one. So it's, in some sense, it's non-perturbative. This is why people, in order to study these inhomogeneities, they use numerical simulation, because basically this is the only method that you have in this regime to study the evolution of those structures. So let me describe for you the theory. They can be larger than one at some places, yes, for sure. I was just sloppy, of course, yes. They can be 10 somewhere. I mean, they are not small. This is all I mean. So let me describe how inflation sees the origin of the fluctuations. So the first of all, we are in the early universe, and we know that in the early universe, the fluctuations are small, and therefore it's a good news, because it means that a perturbative approach is possible, and not only a perturbative approach, but we can even just work at the linear level. So what we do, we take our scalar field, and we add a small piece, delta phi, small compared to phi, and this piece depends on x. So this is not homogeneous. It depends on space. And we do the same thing for the gravitational field. We add a small piece, which is space dependent. Actually, so this means two quantities, one which describes the fluctuation of the scalar field, one which describes the fluctuation in the gravitational field. But actually, the two are related by the Einstein equation. So in fact, there is only one quantity in this business, which is known as the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. And you can view this Mukhanov-Sasaki variable as the amplitude of the curvature perturbation in the early universe. And since we have to consider a linear theory, this means that we can go to Fourier space, because each mode will evolve independently. So this is especially convenient. So this means that, in summary, if you want to study the evolution of this small fluctuation, the only thing you have to do is to follow the evolution in time of the Fourier amplitude of the curvature perturbation. And so we need an equation of motion for this quantity. So in order to obtain an equation of motion for this quantity, what we do is that we take the action of the system, which is the action of gravity, so Einstein-Hilbert action, the action of general relativity, plus a scalar field, and we expand this action up to second order. So second order, because if you want to obtain first order equations of motion from the variation of an action, you need to expand the action up to second order. And so if you do this, this is the action or the Hamiltonian that you get. So this Hamiltonian, I think, is very well known. So P is the conjugate momentum. V is the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. And there is some function here, omega squared. So this is in a standard language, this is p squared plus omega squared x squared. In other words, this is the Hamiltonian of an oscillator. And I have an integral over k, because I am doing field theory, so in fact I have a collection of oscillators. But in fact it's an oscillator, the frequency of which is time dependent, as you can see here. So the details are not important. The only thing which is important here is that the frequency of this oscillator depends on the scale factor and its derivative. So if you know how the universe is expanding, you can immediately calculate the time dependence of this oscillator. And this just follows from GR plus a scalar field, nothing else. So this means that if you vary now, you calculate the equation of motion, the Hamilton equation, the equation that you get for the Bukhanov-Sasaki variable is this one. So this is the equation of a parametric oscillator. So this is not an harmonic oscillator. An harmonic oscillator would be a pendulum. Parametric oscillator is a pendulum, the length of which can change with time. And the way the length of the pendulum is changing with time is completely controlled by the dynamics of the background space. So then you want to quantize the system. So, well, you introduce the wave function and you solve the Schrödinger equation, which is nothing but the Schrödinger equation for the parametric oscillator. And no surprise, the result that you get is a Gaussian state, which is here. But of course, we have to remember that this is an oscillator with a time-dependent frequency. So as a consequence, the variance of this Gaussian state, which I have noted here, omega k, will also depend on time. And if you want to calculate the dependence in time of this Gaussian state, well, you just go this trick, you just perform this change of variable, and you obtain this equation, which is again the equation for the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable. So the equation for the Mukhanov-Sasaki variable that I have obtained is also a tool to calculate the evolution in time of the variance of the Gaussian state that we have here. And so everything is fixed. We have the quantum state of the system. The only thing which is left is the choice of the initial conditions. And the choice of the initial condition, and this is the key assumptions of inflation, is that you start out from the vacuum state. So this means that omega k initially should be given by k over 2, because if I put, in this language, if I put k over 2 here, this means that I have the ground state of an harmonic oscillator. And so this means that I start from the vacuum. And this is all that is present in the inflationary calculation. So if I summarize, and you see again this plot, Hubble scale versus time. So you see that this is constant during inflation, growing during, yes? Where is this energy? Yes, so, yes, in fact, it's a tricky question. Because if you want to, how can I answer this in a simple way? Well, if you want to calculate the energy density, well, first of all, you have this question that you have to, usually we subtract the vacuum contribution in the stress energy density. So the answer to this question is, since you have no particle in the vacuum, the energy would be zero. Yeah, but to prove it exactly, it's a tricky question because you have to compute the stress energy tensor of the perturbations, because the time-time component of this stress energy tensor would be the energy density associated to the fluctuations. And if you want to compute the stress energy tensor of the perturbation, you have to do it at second order, because at first order it is zero. Because at first order, if you perturb the stress energy tensor at first order, I'm sorry, it's a bit technical, but you would obtain something like phi delta phi, but mean value of delta phi is zero by definition. So you need to go one order further, and then this becomes quite tricky. I don't know if I have convinced you. We can discuss it after the talk if you wish, but it's a very good question. It's not an easy question. What do you mean by what form? Well, this would be the energy present in the quantum fluctuations of the field. So I don't know how to say it differently. This would be energy density. So you see, this is exactly the reason why we start from the vacuum. Because if you don't start from the vacuum, if you start from some excited state, then you would the energy density would not be zero, so you would have energy density associated to the fact that you have particles in your initial state, and this energy density would back react on the background and could prevent the onset of inflation. You do not seem to be convinced, but we can discuss it if you wish. So so this is the situation. So here we start well inside the Hubble radius, so we do not feel the expansion of space-time. The initial state is a ground state of the harmonic oscillator, and I have represented this state by its Wigner function, so this is a Gaussian. And then, thanks to the expansion, the modes cross out the Hubble radius during inflation, so they start to feel the expansion of space-time, so the variance of the Gaussian state starts to depend on time, and it depends on time in this way. So this is a representation of the Wigner function. Initially, this is my initial state, and then it becomes squeezed. And actually, you can show that the quantum state of the perturbation at the end of inflation is in fact a two-mode squeezed state. So this is a state which is very well known in quantum optics, as you know better than I do. And we obtain exactly the same state in cosmology, and this follow from the Einstein-Hilbert actions plus a scalar. And what about the value of the squeezing? Let's put some number. So this is the two-mode squeezed state. R is the squeezing parameter. Phi is the squeezing angle. N is here the eigenstate of the number of particles of the radiator. So this is the expression for a two-mode squeezed state. And then comes the question of the value of those squeezing parameters at the end of the equation. So first a remark, you know that the CMB has a black body spectrum. So this is the black body spectrum, is the green line. This has been checked experimentally with very exquisite precision. So the red dots are the measurement by the FIRAS instrument on board of the Kobe satellite. And here, the size of the error bar has been increased by a factor of 400, because otherwise you would not be able to see them. They would be smaller than the thickness of the line. And so this turns out that this spectrum, this black body spectrum, is the best black body spectrum that has ever been produced in nature. So in the lab, we are not able to produce such a perfect black body radiation. And in some sense, it's the same thing turns out to be true for inflation. The value of the squeezing parameter at the end of inflation is something like 100. Why people, and again, you know better than I do, why people, I think, are struggling to achieve R of order a few in the lab. So this map of the CMB and isotropies, in some sense, is actually a photograph of the strongest squeezed state ever produced in nature. Yes, exactly. So let me discuss again a little bit more the physical interpretation of this result. So here I have just written the Hamiltonian of the perturbation again. This is the same Hamiltonian as before, but this time I have written it in terms of the creation and annihilation operators that you can also introduce to deal with the harmonic oscillator. And so what you get is you get two pieces. So the first piece is just the Hamiltonian of collections of harmonic oscillator. And then you get something which looks like an interaction term, which couples K and minus K modes. And here, in front of this term, you have something like a time-dependent coupling constant. So this function is a function which depends only on the background and which is zero if the scale factor is constant. So in Minkowski spacetime, in a static spacetime, you don't have this interaction term, and in a dynamical spacetime, you have this term. So what it means is that, in fact, you have your small perturbation on top of this expanding space-time. You start from the vacuum state, and because the background space-time is dynamical, you extract pairs of particles from the vacuum thanks to the interaction of your quantum field with the classical background. And what you do is that you produce pairs of particles, so one with k, the other with minus k, simply because you start from the vacuum and you have to conserve momentum. So this is another way to understand this effect. And in fact, as it was mentioned yesterday, this effect is actually very well known. And you may think that this is, okay, this is early universe, this is 10 to the 13 GV, maybe this is a bit speculative, but actually this effect is something which is very well known in quantum field theory. And so let me discuss it. In fact, this effect is exactly similar to what is known in quantum field theory as the Schwinger effect. So the Schwinger effect is something that Schwinger computed in the 50s, and it's very well known in field theory because this is one of the few examples in field theory where you can calculate everything exactly. You do not need an expansion or a perturbative approach. So what is the Schwinger effect? Well, it's simple. You take a Dirac field, which represents electrons and positrons, and you put this Dirac field in a constant electric field. And because of the interaction between the quantum Dirac field and the classical source, which is the classical electric field, you will extract pairs of positrons and electrons from the vacuum. And the amplitude is completely controlled by the strength of the classical source, that is to say, by the magnitude of the electric field. Inflation, it's exactly the same. You have some inhomogeneous perturbations of the inflaton field and of the gravitational fields. They are quantum. They interact with a classical source, which is the background gravitational field, the background space-time. And therefore, because of this interaction between a quantum field and the classical source, you extract particles from the vacuum. And the amplitude of the effect is completely controlled by the strength of the source, which means, in that case, the Hubble parameter. And so inflation is nothing but a kind of cosmological Schwinger effect, if you wish. And this would be the same physics for the dynamical Schwinger effect. This would be also the same physics for dynamical Casimir effect. So this is a very general physical phenomenon. Okay, so this was for the theoretical part. Let me now add a few words about observations. So this framework turns out to be very successful as a description of the observations. And why is it so? Because the amplitude of this Mukhanov-Sasaki variable, the amplitude of the curvature perturbations, in fact, we can observe them because they are nothing but the CMB anisotropies that we see on the sky. So we have these fluctuations, and therefore, in order to characterize them, we can calculate their correlation function. So we calculate the two-point correlation function, for instance, and we do it in the Fourier space. So in Fourier space, the two-point correlation function is known as the power spectrum. And the predictions of inflation is that the power spectrum should be a power law with some spectral index, ns, and the prediction of inflation is that ns should be almost 1, but not 1. It should be close to 1, but it should deviate from 1. So ns equal to 1 is known as scale invariance, simply because if you put ns equal to 1 here, you see that the power spectrum does not depend on the scale. So this is what we describe by scale invariance. So the prediction of inflation is that the power spectrum of the fluctuation should be almost scale invariant. And last year, the Planck satellite has measured this number with good precision, and the answer is that ns is 0.96. And for the first time, the Planck satellite has been able to show that ns equal to 1 is excluded at more than 5 sigma. So this is the first time that we have, at a statistically significant level, a proof that the power spectrum deviates from exact scaling values. So this is a beautiful confirmation of inflation, and I stress the fact that this was a prediction of inflation. It was made before the observations were actually performed, and not a prediction. And we have also measured the amplitude of the fluctuation, but here, no surprise, delta T over T is of the order of 10 to the minus 5. The power spectrum is the square of the amplitudes. Therefore, you find that the amplitude of the power spectrum is 10 to the minus 5 squared. That is to say something of the order of 10 to the minus 10. And this is exactly what we get. Yes, exactly. I'm sorry? Yes? No, that's the point. So the fact that you have NS, this value is exactly what allows you to find a good model of inflation, because some of them would predict a different. So all the models of inflation predicts a value of NS which is close to 1, but of course all of them do not predict on 0.96. And this is exactly what allows you to, you know, to distinguish between good and bad. But there is also another nice observational predictions, which is made by inflation, which is less often discussed, which is the following one. So inflation predicts that your curvature perturbation will stay constant on very large scales. And this has very important observational implications that I am going to explain now. So what you can do is that you can also project the power spectrum on the sphere. So instead of Fourier transform everything with plane wave, you Fourier transform everything with spherical harmonics. And you obtain the power spectrum of the delta T over T fluctuation on the celestial sphere. If you do this, this is the kind of plot that you obtain. So this is power of the signal versus angular scale. Small value here means large angular scale, and large values of this of L, the multiple moment, means small angular scale on the sky. The peak, the first peak here, it's about 1 degree or 2 degree. 1 degree, to give you an idea, it's the angular size of the moon on the sky. And Planck has measured this power spectrum with good precision. So this is just history. So this is the measurement of this power spectrum in the 90s. So you see that at that time, we could barely see the rise of the first peak. Then came WMAP with a good measurement of the first and second Doppler peak. And then we have the Planck data with a perfect measurement of something like 7 peaks. And so there is a connection between the fact that zeta is a constant and the presence of this peak. If zeta would not be a constant, we would not, were not a constant, we would not see those peaks. And therefore, inflation predicts the consistency of zeta. In fact, it tells you that the derivative of your curvature perturbation should be exponential minus 50. Why is there a 50? Because 50 is just the number of fifolds between the time at which the scale that we see today cross out the Hubble radius during inflation and the end of inflation. And the value of the derivative at the end of inflation of our fluctuation is exponential minus 50. So it's really a very good constant. And because this is a constant, we see those peaks. So this is also very important predictions of inflation. So I have now 50 seconds to discuss the last part. But actually, I think I can use my 5 minutes to go through the last part. So I will be very quick because I am late. So now, given this situation, comes the question, can we really prove that those fluctuations are of quantum mechanical origin? Is there really an observation, a cosmological or astrophysical observation, that could be a signature, a non-ambiguous signature that this theory is correct, seems to be correct, it fits the data, but can we really see that it comes from quantum mechanics? So to answer this question, let me first tell you something about the discord. So the discord was a quantity introduced by Zurek and Olivier, which allows you to decide whether you are in a situation where, I mean, where you are in a classical situation or in a quantum mechanical situation. The idea is that you imagine a system. The system is made of two subsystems, so it's a bipartite system. And you compute the mutual information in two different ways, in such a way that they coincide if the system is classical, and they may differ if the system is quantum. The discord is just the difference between those two quantities. So if it's zero, the system is classical. If it's non-zero, the system contains quantum correlations. So we have computed recently the quantum discord of the two mode squeezed state. So this is a result that goes beyond just cosmology. And this is what you obtain. So this is zero when the squeezing parameter is zero. Makes sense, because if the squeezing parameter is zero, this is the vacuum state. This is a coherent state. The coherent state is a classical state. And then it grows with the value of R. So this means that at the end of inflation, the quantum discord is big, and which means that, in some sense, the system is very quantum mechanical. And in some sense, it does not come as a surprise, because maybe you have seen on the expression for the two-mode squeezed state that this is an entangled state. So it does not come as a surprise that its quantum discord is. Now, can we see these quantum correlations in the sky? So I give you the answer, and then I try to illustrate this answer if I have some time. So the answer is that in practice, it's very difficult to see, because you can see that all those quantum correlations, they are in fact hidden in the decaying mode. So I told you that the derivative of the curvature perturbation was very small. And in fact, you can show that these quantum correlations, they are hidden in the value of the derivative of the curvature perturbation that we cannot measure because it's too small. So this is a very general conclusion, and you can try different strategies to study this, or try to design an experimental protocol to reveal this quantum correlation, and each time you hit this problem. So, I don't know if I have time to discuss it, but let me just say just a few words. So what we have tried to do is to construct, 2 minutes, okay. What we have tried to do is to construct a cosmological Bell experiment. Because if you have an entangled state, if the discord is big, there should be some quantum correlations in the sky. And, let me skip this. Yes, so you can construct a Bell operator in the sky, which depends on the properties of those cosmological fluctuations. And you can show that this specific Bell operator, in the case of a two-mode squeezed state, violates the Bell inequality. So this is a plot of the mean value of the Bell operator. And you can see that for some values of the squeezing parameter, it is larger than 2. It is always smaller than 2 square root of 2, which means that the calculations are consistent. And so in principle, using the observable that you construct in the sky, you can observe some violations of the Bell inequality. And you can show that, hard to explain in 30 seconds. So let me just say that if you want, so theoretically, you can show that there is a way to violate the Bell inequalities. But if you now try to implement concretely a measurement in order to prove it experimentally, then you can show that this requires the measurement of the derivative of the curvature perturbation. And as I said before, we don't have access. So in some sense, the quantum correlations, they are hidden in the decaying mode, unfortunately. And this is a very general conclusion. You could try other strategies and you will always get the same conclusion. So let me come to the conclusion. So I have shown that according to cosmic inflation, so the CMB are placed in a strongly two-mode squeezed state, which is a discordant state, a big quantum discord, and it is an entangled state. Unfortunately, a quantum mechanical signature in the sky seems to be hidden in the decaying mode. Is there a way out? Okay, we think that there is a way out, so we are actively working on that at the moment. And just give you the idea. The idea would be not to consider Bell inequalities, because I have shown that you cannot have access to them observationally, but would be to consider the Leggett-Gark inequality, so measuring one quantity but at different time, which in this case would mean at different regions. And we have recently proven that for a two-mode squeezed state, the Leggett-Gark inequalities are violated. So we hope that in this way we could maybe obtain a signature. This would be a shortcut to the previous theory. Of course, inflation can also be used to test theories beyond quantum mechanics, such as spontaneous collapse or De Broglie Bohm formulations, and there have been some papers on that. And the takeaway message is just that inflation is not only a successful scenario which allows you to understand absolutely everything about the data that come from the early universe, but also it's also, I think, an interesting framework which allows you to understand something about quantum mechanics, especially in the cosmological context. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jerome. While the next speaker is setting up, maybe there's someone who has a short question that does not include the slides, so that we have a quick change. Yes.
What collapses your wave function?
You can ask to your neighbor, he will tell you. I don't know. But it's true that here, as in quantum mechanics, I think there is this measurement problem, which is maybe worst in the cosmological case. And I think it's fair to say that there is no well-accepted answer to that question. So here I was just assuming that you just produce one realization of your quantum mechanical process and work. I gave no explanation for the production of this outcome.
Okay, thank you.